pleasure to be here. It's so nice to be here and meet you all. And it's been a joy to spend the last couple of days here at Georgia TESOL. Wow, y'all just right out of the park, knocking it right out of the park. I really want to say a thank you to Dr. Elizabeth Webb and to Dr. Dave Kieska. Thank you so much for inviting me, and to all of the board for Georgia TESOL. Again, y'all doing such fantastic work here in Georgia, and it's such a pleasure. And thank you so much for preparing and talking about rural communities. This is near and dear to my heart, for sure, so I'm so grateful. I just thought I'd start by saying, if you are a rural teacher in this room, will you please stand up? All right. Thank you so very much for your work and your dedication. Thank you so very much. And so we acknowledge each other and the hard work that you're doing, knowing that our challenges are somewhat different. We're going to talk about that a little this morning. But, you know, I was doing this funny thing yesterday. I was on the Whova app, right? And so I was like, well, let me see if I put out a poll what people will say, what comes to mind when you hear the word rural. So I said, okay. So I had like about 10 or so people respond, and here's what we got. Small town with one high school and 2 to 3 elementary schools, small town community, remote country, I love this one, out in the boonies, low population for large area, underdeveloped, agriculture, farm life, low population, countryside slash small population, small farm town, farming, undeveloped, lacking resources, country, or county, I think it says, not my district, and I have country. And so that is so fascinating to me, the way we're thinking about and conceptualizing rural schools and communities. So with that, I just want to get started. I think what I'd like to do is take a bird's eye view and start really broad here this morning and kind of give the overall picture. And then what I'd like to do as we go through in the presentation is narrow in on what I think are some very important principles for engaging rural multilingual learner families and students in rural communities. But again, as we've mentioned, a lot of this work is very much applicable to the work you're doing if you are in small town Georgia, suburban Georgia, or in urban Georgia. I think these are really important principles, but they're especially poignant in rural communities. So what you have here is a QR code that should be accessible for all of the PowerPoint presentation. So feel free to get that, and we'll make this available, of course, through Georgia TESOL and your app. So feel free. Now, this is an important kind of a starting point, right? And what you see here in this image is our migratory people. And you see this going on. And the question I have for us all this morning is, the world is changing rapidly, right before our eyes. And are you prepared? Because I think what we've been doing, we've been trying so hard in education to catch up to where we need to be. And rural communities that function very differently than urban spaces have always had this sense of, we got to catch up, we got to do like what's going on. And those are not the same spaces, so I'm going to differentiate that. But the question we have before us as educators is, are we prepared for what's coming? And we know, for instance, that immigration and social change are happening right before our eyes. This is the world we're in. I'm just giving you here a few pieces of data from the United Nations, the Center for Refugee Studies, and you can see these numbers are about people that are internally or externally displaced. Many of our families are from these backgrounds, so I'm just making the case here that we know we haven't even begun to touch upon things like climate change, and 1 billion people will have to move because they will be living in places they can no longer survive. Water, drought, and all of the things, food production, and so on. So we know we're trying to think about where we are today, but where we are going to be in 10 years. So just thinking about that to set us up, there's a lot changing. Now, what's happening with the English learner experience in immigrant communities for certain? We know we have a lot of things like, in the United States, more than 5 million of our students are English learners identified across the states, okay? We know that. It's a little bit more than that right now. Okay, but we have a persistent anti-immigrant sentiment that our work collectively, we're dispelling a lot of these myths about what's happening, but these are international trends. We face persistent kinds of discrimination. And for language, we know this is really true. Language, race, ethnicity. We have an overrepresentation of immigrants and EL students who live in poverty conditions. That's across the board. Every of our 50 states, this is a reality that we're facing. And we know our students that are from refugee backgrounds, asylum seekers, or who have moved because of agricultural reasons. They move across school district lines. They might have interrupted education. They come to our schools, and we serve all of our students in our schools, okay? They lack access to mental and physical health services. This has become such an important issue in rural communities in the past 5 or 6 years that every time I go to a rural community, one of the things educators tell me repeatedly is we don't have bilingual social workers. And it's hard to provide those services in languages children and families do not speak. In fact, I would argue it's probably not possible at all. Okay, big issue. And you see here, barriers to access higher education. Just short little story here. So I was in North Carolina, and we were thinking about this issue, about how our kids, when they get to 10th grade, 11th grade, and they're applying to go to colleges and universities in North Carolina, which we want them all to have access to, that they need to fill out a form, go online and fill out a form called an RDS. North Carolina residency form. And I think this exists in many, many states. I know the two or three other states I've worked in, this something like this exists. Well, our US-born students, our US-born US citizen students who have lived in North Carolina their whole lives also have to fill out a residency form. But the law is that the prima facie test for their residency status is the legal status of the parent or caregiver. So what we have when we have families whose parents are one or both are not documented and the children want to go to college, they're getting rejected for in-state tuition because of this residency issue. This is an equity issue. We have kids that need to go to college and they can't afford three times tuition, international tuition, right? So they've got to face this, and what has to happen is they have to get rejected, and then they have to know to appeal, and then they've got to go through an interview process. Anyway, you can see where this is going, right? It's not going very far. So these are barriers to access that are structural that we have to be vigilant of and aware so we can make changes and advocate where we need to. And the last thing on this slide is we know we have increasing numbers of our multilingual learners, that's a term we use in North Carolina, English learners in rural communities across the entire country, so much so that our colleagues that work in national demographic data, social data, are saying that rural communities are being repopulated by Latino immigrants primarily, and they are a demographic lifeline to rural communities because of the labor they provide to our communities. Okay, so this is an important issue. It's here, it's in North Carolina, came from Florida before that. It's across the country. So what is rural then? Let's just take a look. 1/4 of all of our students attend rural schools. 1/3 of all schools in the US are considered rural. 1/2 of all districts are considered rural. 9.3 million students are rural. And there are about 500,000 identified rural English learner students. Now I say about because if you look at the federal data, it's going to tell you a different story. But I would argue if you go from one state to the other, you know our exit criteria on the WEDA test, on the access test, are different from one state to the other. A student might be identified rural, might be identified EL in one state and not in another, right? We know that. We also know that in rural communities, we might not be capturing all the students in our screeners and so on, or there may be a delay in identification. So I would argue that number might even be low. Okay, so what does rural look like in America? Just take a second and look at this map. This is the US Census data. Every green space on that map is rural, according to the US Census. Are you shocked or what? I mean, all right, that's everywhere. That's everywhere. That's just everywhere. So our urbanized centers are the parts that are not green. And so we are a very rural country overall. But you wouldn't even think it, right? Because we're so used to gravitating toward urbanized spaces and urbanized ways of thinking of education for our multilingual learners. Okay, but I want to go a little bit deeper here. So what happens? We know that rural is not the same in one place or another. In fact, my colleagues that work in rural education, they love to say this, and I have to always repeat it. When you've seen one rural community in the US, you've seen one rural community in the US because they're all vastly different. And it's so important to note this. What you see on this image here are two different rural communities, and they're both images that I took in North Carolina. So right up the road, we're not that far from each other. On the top right, you see what's a poultry processing plant. And this plant is located in what's called a fringe rural community. Now, I could go into the definitions, but let me just say, if you look up federal definitions of rurality, there are more than 70 different definitions. That's 70. So more than that. So we use certain definitions in the federal and education, but what I want, the point is that that fringe rural community is located relatively close to an urbanized space. So that tells me lots of things. Tells me there's maybe more access to public transportation, there's maybe a less sense of isolation, the industry base is very different, families definitely migrate, they will go for work, they'll cross school district lines and work maybe in a more urbanized location, and that's what they do because they're in a fringe rural place. In this particular community, you see that that about 31% or 32% of the children are Hispanic, and about 10.5% are identified in that district as English learners. Okay. Then you look at the image down in the bottom right, and this is on the other end of rural. These are remote rural communities. So this is a really interesting community. We did a very interesting linguistic landscape analysis of this community about 6 months ago. And I'll tell you more about that if you want to know. But it's fascinating. Remote rural. So that means the farthest away from an urbanized center. Now, I'm not trying to paint a dichotomy, urban versus rural. I'm not trying to do that. But that happens a lot in the way we think about rurality. Is it rural or is it urban? We don't think about the nuances and what rural really means, okay? So in the second image here, you see this is a community that in the last 15 years has gone from 0% Hispanic to 55%. The data are a little bit lower here, and I can see that, but I was there in March, and it was 55% of the children in the school, one school, are Hispanic. Okay, and so all those children speak Spanish, and there are no native language programs at all, and in fact, I didn't find a book in Spanish in the school. All right, so these are very different spaces, and so it's hard to say they're both rural. All right, so what's happening? I took this picture. I did a little bit of homework on Georgia. I had a lot of fun with that. That was great. But I want to start here with this picture on the top right. Why does rural matter? When you meet someone for the first time, you're pretty likely to ask them, where are you from? And the reason we do that is because we have a sense of how place and how space matters to the development of human beings, to who we are as people, to the way we experience life. I love this picture on the top right. It's a French word, it's terroir. And so if you look at this picture, you'd be like, what I see are vineyards. I love red wine. So I always put the pictures of vineyards. So the vineyards, you see vineyards, and you think, okay, this is an agricultural community. It's a rural community. But if you look really carefully at this image, you might start to see, if you had the image bigger, you might start to see that between the rows of the vines are little rocks. And the reason there are little rocks there is because when the sun shines down onto the vineyards, the rocks glitter, right? They reflect the sun up into the underneath part of the leaf. And so the vineyards grow, and the farm workers put these there strategically because it helps in the growing of the wine. And the wine is very much, when they produce it, very, very connected to the soil. There are minerals in the soil that make one region taste of wine taste very different than another region, very, very different. The other thing you don't realize here in this picture, but when you think about the roots of a vine, they grow deep, deep down into the earth. And in fact, the more a vine struggles, the better the wine. It actually has a deeper, richer flavor. And the vines, the roots that grow down into the earth, you don't see them, but the farmers regularly do not water on the top of the soil for the wine. One, they want the vine to struggle because the wine's better. But number two is they want those roots to grow deep, deep down and find their own water source so they are stronger, okay? There's so much that happens in rural community. And this is kind of a metaphor for what I think about rural communities, right? There's a lot we see on the surface, but the way rural communities function is very rich, sophisticated, and lots of things that happen below the surface that we don't automatically see. Okay, so just setting that up, that the essence of rurality matters. What I put up here also is a picture of a really interesting article that I encourage you to read. And I'm going to say this, so someone up here might help me pronounce Taliaferro County. Did I say that right? Taliaferro County. Did I get it? Thank you, Taliaferro County. Okay, Taliaferro County. We had a debate over at the table. We were like, wait. We had four different ways to pronounce at the table. So this is an interesting story about, and I think it captures rurality really well. All you see is a school bus. But when you look at this school bus, you can see a rundown school bus. Did you know that school buses are so interesting in rural communities? Number one, you need a school bus. If you're living in a rural community, you got to pick up kids. Number two, you might get them there in the morning, and they may be on that bus for 30 minutes, 45 minutes, an hour before they get to school. Number three, do you know after school the bus comes and takes them home, but that means your district is, they're probably not hanging out after school for after school programs. Number four, did you know that to fit these school buses, to retrofit these school buses with air conditioning, it's $10,000 each bus. Number five, did you realize that in the state of Georgia, from what I read, that the funding cuts have been so severe for this funding stream, comes out of a different pot of money, but that's so severe that now local school districts, all school districts, are paying 80% of the cost of buses, and only 20% is now coming from the state. Number six, you realize that the school bus drivers, they are making below minimum wage, right? So they're making minimum wage, but the funding for them, for their benefits and so on, has been also cut as funding cuts have happened. This has been so severe across the entire country. And we're thinking, remember I said climate change, right? Air conditioning and all that. So severe that in North Carolina, one of the rural districts I work with, I was out talking to the ESL lead, and really interesting, and she was telling me, well, they couldn't get bilingual instructional aides in the school district, and they also couldn't get bus drivers. So the superintendent had this idea, and you can decide if it's a great idea or not. But the superintendent said, well, for every instructional aide we get, we're going to insist that the instructional aide gets a bus driver's license. So we need bilingual instructional aides, but we also need bus drivers, so we're going to require that they have both. Well, you know what happened. They didn't get either, right? So all right, you don't get either, right? So because, you know, our instructional aides, our bilingual aides, or our family liaisons, they didn't come into the job to drive the bus, right? You know, and we need bus drivers. And again, this is a bus driver shortage across the entire country, but it's especially hurtful and affecting rural communities. The cost of gasoline and the wear and tear on buses is astronomical. So again, these are rural spaces that we've got to pay attention to. And this last image here on the right, you just see that, you know, in case you didn't know, you probably do know, that most of the funding for education, about half of the funding, comes from local property taxes. Okay? So if you are in an agricultural community, farmers typically, I know, don't pay the same cost for property taxes as a suburban location, right? So your property tax base is very, very low. It's already low, and you've got all of these other things to consider. Okay, so we can sort of paint the picture of what's kind of going on in rural, across all of rural America. I think, obviously, you got one really nice image already of the rural, better than this image, rural districts in Georgia. And so by comparison, in North Carolina, 80 of our 100 school districts are rural. 80, that's 80%, of course, you know. But here I was looking at the districts. I had different numbers for RLIS data. That's Rural Low-Income School Supplemental Funding that rural districts can get, a little bit of extra money. But one community in Georgia wrote a grant. They received a federal grant. And in their grant proposal, they wrote, Georgia is facing a rural education crisis. And this crisis is widespread across the country. We are just now starting to pay attention to this crisis with our rural English learner students and families in America. And for that, I am incredibly grateful. Okay, So at the intersection of rural and English learner education, we have lots of things. You can see these data, and I'll share them with you. You can see them in the PowerPoint, of course. But just notice that our rural communities have lower access to specialized human resources, lower access to bilingual paraeducators or instructional aides, least likely to put a bilingual program out there, less likely to put out sheltered instruction as a method. And I just want to share with you those two lines at the bottom. North Carolina, these are from North Carolina data, but I have one school district that I work with. It's right up, it's in the other direction, it's up on the Virginia border. That district has 720 identified ML, we use ML there, multilingual learners, and they have 2.5 ESL teachers for 720 children. Yeah, you can't. Why 2.5? Because the secondary Spanish teacher coordinates the program half the day. He's half of his time, school time, goes toward the EL program. They know they need 10. They said that, actually, the district lead said, I need 10. I said, you need 20. You know, and but okay, so, or more. So, all right, so that's one. And then in the same, you can drive 2 hours the other direction, and our other district has a ratio of 1 to 40 teachers, ESL identified, certified ESL teachers for 40 identified ML students. This is an equity issue, my friend. These are equity issues. We've got to dig deep into what's happening in those spaces. And then the other one, as I was coming down here yesterday, I got a phone call. I was actually at the airport, and a district called me, and this is a district that's on the border of South Carolina. And so the district lead called me, and we have a friend in common, and she said, you know, in the last 5 years, we went from 2,000 identified ML students to 3,500. That is a rapid change. When I tell you things are changing, you can see what I mean across the entire country. Okay. But I don't want to leave you with bad news. Okay. In fact, what's so beautiful about rural communities, besides the fact that they're beautiful communities and the way they function, is the strength of the educators and the people in those spaces. I mean, I can't underscore enough the most amazing things happen in places that are rural. I want to share with you some work. This is work that's been done by my colleague, Lonnie Crum, who's at Eastern Carolina University. It's a really good paper I'd be happy to share with you. And she identifies all of these strengths that come through rural communities. Things like rural resourcefulness. I mean, I think about this with rural educators. One school district I worked with in Florida a few years ago, the secondary Spanish teacher is Puerto Rican. She speaks Spanish, but she loves computers. So she does all the district computer PD, right? Small rural community. So she's teaching secondary Spanish. She does the computer PD for the district. She decided that she would implement a seal of biliteracy. So she took on for the whole district how to get AP classes in Spanish for her Latino immigrant kids and introduced the whole curriculum and got these kids to pass the ACTFL test, the Spanish language portion ACTFL test, and their test in English. In Florida, they have a 10th grade test they have to pass in English language arts. And those kids got a seal of biliteracy. She took all of that on, and she did all of the interpretation for the district when they needed her. And when it got time for families to fill out the FAFSA form, she had all the families come in to help them do that. This is rural resourcefulness. This is what rural educators do. They play these multiplicitous and faceted kinds of roles because there's only one person to do it, right? So we see this in rural communities. It's a strength. Rural ingenuity, finding solutions to problems when you don't have the resources, all over rural communities, right? And you see things like this image on the left, the top one on the left. It looks like if you were just kind of driving through, you'd be like, oh, there's a lot of old broken down. No, that's rural ingenuity. Because if you're in a rural community, you realize that you're not going to throw away those car parts or those tractor parts. You're going to need them for something else coming up in the future. Like, you just don't throw that away. No, that's ingenuity. One major strength is rural familism. Families function in very tight units. And in rural communities, those are extended into the community as if they're kin kinds of relationships. Rural community unity, working together as a team, huge strength, right? Because those people, there's only one or two, and they play these important complex roles. And then I want to end with this idea of rural resilience, withstanding and overcoming hardships over time. These are strengths that are coming through in lots of research, and I want to say the work of you educators, thank you so much for all that you're doing and with our rural ELs. So just to kind of switch the conversation a little bit, has painted sort of a picture of what's happening in rural America and across with our rural multilingual learners, is that how can we reimagine communities, comunidad, and connections for rural EL families? One of the things educators say, it's so interesting, is that the one area, actually the two main areas that educators say, working with EL, say that they have trouble with, that they'd like more preparation in. One is in linguistics. So, like, how many people love linguistics here?
Yeah.
Oh, all right, Dave, we got you. All right, we got some linguistics lovers. Everybody go to Dave. He's going to tell you about all the linguistic subsystems. And so the other one is with multilingual or EL family engagement. This is an area that is repeatedly, I want to say for 40 years, has come up as like the number one or number two issue. And I wonder why, when we have more toolkits that come from OELA, you know, we have every, I think every 8 or so years, they give us another toolkit for engaging families. It's a shifting space, I understand that, but there's a lot of things I think that we could do slightly differently that would make a big impact. So I'd like to kind of go through some of those ideas, and I'm going to tell you, I'm going to come back to this after, I'm going to go, kind of go forward just in the sake of time. I want to give you like four key principles that I've learned over many years in terms of research, reading the research, doing research, working with families. That is just my heart. When my love for working with this population is really working with families. And so this has come through many, many years of work, and I've sort of come through with these four main principles that I would like to share with you. The first one is building representation of EL students' identities. So representatives, we look around your school, look around, look on your walls, look in your bookshelves, and listen in the halls. How well are our EL students represented in school and community spaces? That's a good question. All right. The second principle is creating a shared vision for ELs. That's all educators with schools and with families. That's a hard task, but I'm going to put that out there as a principle for engaging rural and non-rural EL families. Number three, creating bridges, puentes, bridges, between the school and the community. Okay, so schools are easy. We're easy to feel like we're our own little ecosystem because everything functions in that school. And so it's harder to look outside beyond that and make those connections into the community. So I'm going to talk about that. And then finally, I'm going to challenge us to center or recenter and decolonize family engagement practices. Okay, let's get into those. Okay, so the first one, repeat after me, representation.
Representation.
All right. The second one, shared vision.
Shared vision.
Muy bien. The third one, bridges.
Bridges.
Or puentes. Muy bien, muy bien. And the fourth one is decolonize.
Decolonize.
All right, there we go. Going to have to remember those later. There's a mini quiz at the end. Okay. All right, so these are coming from some research. I'm not going to go through all of it, but I'd be very, very happy to share some of the research. But just so you see, some of this comes from very long-standing professional development in rural communities that I've done. Some comes from a study I did of 5 exemplary leaders of multilingual or EL students. And this study I did internationally, Ireland, 2 schools in the US are the ones I'm going to highlight, Poland and South Africa. A study of family engagement practices, but I've been doing this over many years. And then the linguistic landscape analysis I was recently telling you about. So I'll give you those data if you want them after. But here's the 3 schools I want to highlight just for today. The first one you see on the left, I'm calling it Celebration Elementary School. And you can see what it looks like, right? The building and so on. They have their mascot out in the front. Rural school. Second rural school we'll call Wilmington Elementary School. And you can see beautiful sky around it, but kind of got to walk through the gates, you know. Schools are often gated up, and so gated, so you can walk through the gates into the main office. And this school has multiple buildings around the campus. And the third school we'll call Estrella School. And this is, you can see, this is a big building. It's got multiple floors to it. That is a rural school district, okay? So, and I'll tell you a little bit more about those. This is just what the schools look like. And what happened in these schools? Well, you know, we all think about the kinds of educational models and programs for the EL students that are in there. You see, so Celebration School, they had mainstream, it was a mainstream program with ESL. and a DLI track. So they had dual language immersion in that school, in Celebration School. And they've done that since 2013. The DLI, the dual language immersion program, has been in that rural school since 2013. That's 10 years, that's interesting. 700 students or so, PK to 5 school. They have some new Ukrainians coming in, mostly Latino students from across all of Latin America. And they're EL families, mostly from Latin America and some, again, refugee background students. And they are a remote rural school. So now you kind of know the difference, right? They're remote rural. The second school, Estrella School, has a dual language immersion program since 2016, and they've moved to the whole school becoming dual language immersion. They have ESL push-in support as well for those kids. 225 K-6 students, 98% of them are immigrant Latinos. And the immigrants, again, are mostly from, in this school, Latin America, mostly migrant farm workers in agriculture. And this is a distant rural community, okay? So it's in between rural, remote and fringe. All right, and then the last school is Wilmington. I spent a lot of years down. We're working with educators there. They have what's called, and you'll see this, a mainstream classroom instructional model. Now, before we did a lot of PD, we worked with that school. They're really good friends, right? You know, these are our friends. We're working together to identify how we can support students and families. They told me that their model was a spread them around model. You know what the spread them around model is? Anyone know the spread them around model? Spread them, you can imagine what spread them around. Well, we, you know, teachers are evaluating school grades are a result of a lot of the test scores of our EL students. And so the district thought they would do the spread them around model by putting just like two kids here, two kids with that teacher, two kids with that teacher, so it wouldn't affect the teacher evaluation at the end of the year. And then I told them, spread them around is not a model. So that's not a model. But they did something really radical I want to tell you about. They created a community classroom model at the end of about 5 or 6 years of working together, really interesting. And so their students come from Puerto Rico, Mexico, Guatemala, and they are a fringe rural community. Okay, and then there are these amazing leaders. Now I would argue that we do a lot of teacher professional development. We do a lot of, much of this. But especially in a rural district, if we don't have our leaders involved and embedded, and I don't mean just showing up for a specialized PD, but I mean invested, embedded, then because of these multiplicitous kinds of roles, we don't have the same effects on changes that we know need to happen. So here we have the leaders of these, not all leaders, but leaders and teachers in these studies. One I want to highlight, her name is Zoe. I'm calling her Zoe, that's really not her real name, okay, of course. But she grew up in a migrant farm working community as a migrant farm worker herself. Barbara, a veteran elementary teacher, teacher of the year for many years. Interesting, right? Putting your best teachers with these children is a really important instructional and programmatic decision. But mainstream teacher. And Margarita is a teacher who comes from Chile and certified, and she's working in a rural community, and she was very concerned about immigrant integration and the responsible the principal asked her to be responsible for family engagement practices. So there they look. Okay. So now I want to just tell you what happened in these spaces and how these come out, some examples of these four: representation, shared vision, building bridges, puentes, and these decolonizing practices. So I'm going to give you a couple of examples, and I have a few, we think our audio will work in just a minute. Okay, so the first one, this principle, is representation. And when I think about this, I think about it in two ways, and these come through in lots of research. I see you. These are examples in schools where we really demonstrate and show that the backgrounds, cultures, languages of the students we serve are represented in the school community. We see them. We want them to know that we see them. We want them to know that they're valued, because when we value them, we value their language. We value their language, we value them. So here we have material and physical spaces that reflect English learners and represent the students and families. And again, in the halls, on the walls, and on the shelves, right? So you see just a few examples here of books. There was a great presentation yesterday of all the bilingual books that came out. There's lots of great options. Bilingual books. You know what's interesting about multilingual learner kids? It's fascinating. I've run a couple book projects rural book projects, really interesting. But when you put a book, a bilingual book, in front of a child, And you open it up, and you've got like some of it's in English and some of it's in Spanish. And they start looking, ay, maestra, mira, like en español se usa 10 palabras. In Spanish they use 10 words, in English it only needs 7 words. Right? They immediately start contrasting what's happening in one language and what's happening in the other. And ojo, that's your best instructional tool right in that moment. That is called contrastive linguistics. And those kids that are multilingual, they see themselves and their languages represented in those books. And even if they can't decode in both of those languages, although I'd argue that that would be the best approach, even if they can't, they are contrasting those languages all the time. And that's what happens in the multilingual brain. It is the executive functioning, the frontal lobe for a multilingual has to adjudicate language 100% of the time. Those bilingual, multilingual kids are so bright, they don't even realize they're doing it. And again, our best instructional tool is showing them how these languages intersect, even if it's just on the surface. But some other examples here, you see the second image is from a Wax Museum event that took place in a dual language program. And this was really interesting. The children got to choose their famous person from Hispanic culture or a culture that they love. So this boy chose Roberto Clemente, famous baseball player. And it was phenomenal. You would just kind of go up to the little, you can see the little button there on the front of the table. Go up to the button and you press the button and you'd tell the boy Spanish or English. And so if you said Spanish, he would say, me llamo Roberto Clemente y soy jugador de baseball, or whatever he was saying, right? And then if you said, okay, you press the button again and you say English, he'd say, my name is Roberto Clemente and I'm a baseball player. I mean, it was really, really sweet example. But here you have an example of both language and culture represented, it's representing the children who are in those spaces and the families. And it was really amazing. The families came in for this event and had a great time because families could choose. They wanted to hear their child speak in both languages. Really fun. The next image was at an ESL family engagement night. And this was kind of moving through the academic year where the educators realized that the families really didn't talk a lot. I'm going to come back to this idea. The families were kind of there, and they felt that they were sort of just receiving, on the receiving end of getting lots of information. So the educator said, wait a minute, we got to figure out how to make sure that families from different cultures and backgrounds see themselves represented. And they put together these posters as families came in, and their cultures were represented at the entranceway, which was a really nice first step. Okay, but also in terms of representation, I just want to say it's also you see me. So I see you and you see me, and here are some examples of some of my colleagues. There's Mr. G. We have in the second from the right, we have Nancy and Adriana Perez, who were students of mine, who are now working as instructional aides or Latinas, both from, Nancy's from Mexico. She's a DACA card holder. Adriana was born in the United States. But they are increasingly in important roles, okay? You see on the right, Grisel Cuadrado, she's a principal at a rural elementary school. And so it's not only represented in the spaces that we work in, but also people who are from those spaces are increasingly, obviously, in places of leadership and other places in the schools in which we teach. Okay, principal one. Okay, the second principle I'd like to tell you about is this idea of having a shared vision for ELs. And I really want to, again, underscore the role of rural schools in this shared vision. Having everybody involved in a vision for the English learners goes a very long way. And this is not only the teachers and the instructional coaches and specialists who have a stake already in the population, but also, especially in rural schools, it's the school counselors, it's the leaders, and it's the bilingual paraeducators or family liaisons. In my work with the family liaisons, I keep seeing this repeatedly, that the liaisons feel like they're under-professionalized. Their language skills, they feel, are not valued to the degree that they know matters or they think matters. They're out working with families. So creating these professional spaces where everybody is involved is critical. It's critical that there's a shared vision. Now, a couple of examples I'd like to give you here are from Zoe's school. Again, she's the principal of the three-story school building, the big school building you saw. And when I went into the teacher's room, she really portrayed this in all of the work that she did as a leader. She said, she put this in the teacher's room, to the world we are just a team, but to each other we are family. And she created this sense of family in her school where everybody's idea was valued. I happened to be in the school, we were doing some writing work, bilingual writing work, and a mother came in and she had a very sad story. Her husband had been picked up and put into a deportation center. And this mom was very dependent on, they were very dependent on the father's labor. And the children were quite disrupted, right? Because obviously, this is the biggest fear of our immigrant families, that a parent is gonna be, there's gonna be family separation, the biggest fear they face. So she came in and brought her whole team to come up with solutions to help the family and help the children while they were in the school and even after school. She was phenomenal, and I could tell you some more of the details, but this is teams of educators providing support for families in their needs in those rural spaces. Critical, absolutely critical, because they had a shared vision for those children. Another example was Barbara, who worked with leadership to redesign grades 4 and 5 in the community classroom. I'm going to give you more on this and what happens, but there was also a sense of not only shared vision, but autonomy among the teachers that worked in that program. Okay, so shared vision. Okay, the third principle is this idea of building bridges, and here is moving the schools from beyond just its own nucleus out into the community. Really important. If you go into probably most of your school districts, there is a local public library. How many schools share spaces or share events with the local public library? Very few. I'm astounded. They're public libraries. Imagine a space where your local public library has stories of families, testimonials on how they arrived to your rural community, what they contribute to labor, and so on. That would be a beautiful shared space where families and children are sharing materials and ideas, okay, in the local library. And I want to tell you about Zoe. I'm going to click here. Oh, we might be able to, I'm not sure if I can get the audio to what Zoe said. There we go.
In our community, that's primarily our demographics, is our families. So I think you have to have them look for what you want for the future of the family that you serve. And I think just being part of it and being more connected with the community itself, it made it that much easier for me to just do what I love to, you know, and bring just these programs into effect, you know, our Saturday camps, our after school study halls, our, like, all of that just started to unfold itself because I kind of knew where we could do better and serve our families and kids. So that's wonderful to be able to do that for the community that really, that helped, you know, help me go to school and help me achieve my goals in life. And I really love the fact that I get to give back.
Okay. So here you have some inroads into the community that she loves so much. And finally, I just want to share with you this idea, the fourth principle of centering and decolonizing family engagement practices. So I know that's kind of that's a big term, this decolonization, this idea. But you can see I put a continuum. I put an arrow that goes both ways. And I'm just going to challenge us to think about where family engagement practices currently sit on this continuum of ideas. So you see, for instance, on the left-hand side, this is a school that had a family engagement night, and the educators did an outstanding job. But they started with this idea of the families needed to have access to power school. And so entering into the building, this is what the families saw when they got in. After about 15 or 20 minutes, the families were given an application for Power School, and they were told, basically, that they had to come back to the school on Monday and use a special code, access a computer in the front office, and they could learn how to use, they would get access to PowerSchool. What's really interesting is that the families kind of took this information and they kind of put it in their pocket, and I was just watching, they put it in their pocket, and they left, right? So just thinking about what families were receiving in that one family engagement event was not really the kind of family engagement that would help them access PowerSchool. But most importantly was they didn't know what to do with PowerSchool once they had access. Okay? So, and we know that the research in family engagement is that the most important thing that families can do is to have conversations about education in the home. So PowerSchool is a tool to help families have conversations in the home about education. And I want to just fast forward over here to the last picture on the right. In contrast, some other amazing ideas that educators have done in decolonizing and recentering families is getting families to learn about and talk with each other. So important. So in this particular event, the school decided that they would, when families signed in for ESL or for family night, that they would put next to the sign-in sheet a sticker, and families, and behind the families when they signed in was a map, a huge map of the world. And you can see part of this map is Latin America. As families signed in, they were encouraged to put a sticker next to where they came from or where their families came from. I couldn't believe it. This was the first time that I saw educators and families get together and talk about where they were from and what they knew, what languages they spoke. And the fascinating thing was families were saying, wow, look, you're from Veracruz. I'm from Hidalgo. Oh, I'm from Guatemala. The families were able to speak with each other and share their background with each other. And you can see in this picture right next to it, the most important and beautiful moment was these families. You can see a mother and a father. There are actually two children in this family. The parents are showing their children where they're from. They did not realize. This was a moment of celebration, of languaging, of practices that centered families, what they knew, where they were from, the languages that they spoke at the beginning of this family engagement event. And I tell you what, it was fascinating. Those families stayed for 2 hours getting to know each other. I'd never seen that before. That was really a recentering and decolonizing. Nobody was talking to the families and telling them what they needed to do. Families were at the center of this event, and it was a fantastic moment. And that's a great starting point for other events to happen. Okay, so I just want to leave you, I'll go a little bit more quickly for time, but just through what happened at Celebration, what happened in Estrella School, and what happened in Wilmington School, where they created these multilingual spaces for families and for students. And I'm going to actually have you, there's one last video here I'll have you listen to. This is from Wilmington School. She'll tell you her school. And it's not 12 minutes long. This is raw footage from a film that we created called Small Town, Big Dreams. The entire film is about 15 minutes long, and you can access it from the QR code. But here's a short clip from the teacher.
You have to understand the students that you educate to be able to teach in a school like this. For me, I grew up in a school like this. So I went to a school that was high poverty. I was, because I was not going to use lunch growing up. I went to the same school building that my parents had gone to growing up. So very small community, even smaller than Williston. And I understood what it was like to not have resources at home that other students may have, and to have to work a little bit harder to get the same quality of education. So you have to have an understanding of your kids, because you can't make blanket statements and have the same expectation of every student. And if you're in this for personal glory or for the idea that you are setting out to educate the minds of others and you're kind of that top-down approach as a teacher, you're not going to succeed in a school like this, because in a school like this, you have to celebrate even the small successes. You have to look at where they came from to where they're going to be now, that they're not necessarily going to be proficient, but you have to accept the level of growth that they're able to give you, the level of learning that they can do in the circumstances in which they live.
Yeah, so know your students, right? So lots of important information in this. And just going forward here, I would just like to ask you, for those that are still here, to think about these four principles that I talked about: representation, shared vision, building puentes, and recentering families. So here is a QR code, okay? And so it leads to a Padlet. And so if you would just mark down which of these principles, what is one of these that resonates most with you that you think you could implement or you could work at or work toward in the schools or the school or schools that you serve and the families, then please go ahead and do that. And I think we can in a second just switch the screens. Okay, we're gonna switch the screens and see what you came up with. Let's see. Oh, okay. We might see. It would be at the top tab. Okay, that one, yes. Okay, let's see. All right. Great. I like this, decolonizing and bridges. I feel like these two pieces woven together can change a school. Thank you so much. Yay, representation, we can do that. I see you, yes, I see you, absolutely. I build puentes in my community. Fantastic work. Wow, y'all fantastic. Excited to collaborate. Thank you so, so much. So we'll go back. Yeah. So I just want to end us out here and say that this is fantastic. So I am so excited to see all of your ideas here. And I think these are some examples of hope that we can bring to rural schools in particular, but to schools and families. And okay, I have a couple of quotes here. I love this. Radical hope is not so much something you have, but something you practice. It demands flexibility, openness, and imaginative excellence. So thank you so much. And that's it. Thank you so much for having me. And I'd like to actually have a few books that I'd like to give out. Yeah? Okay.
Can we do that at lunch?
We can do that at lunch. Okay. Yes, we can. Okay.
Thank you.